So if you have a Bible this morning, I encourage you to turn to Joshua chapter 4. If you don't have a Bible, you can download one on a smartphone if you've got one, or the team today is going to do really a great job of following me, and the words will be behind me on the screen. And I'm going to talk to you today about the people of God moving into the promised land. Now, let me backfill this story for you, just in case, you know, this is your first time in a church experience, and you may not know the story, or maybe just need a refresher course on what it is. So long story, God has taken his people, the Israelites, out of Egypt, which was a massive world power at the time. They were in slavery. God led a man named Moses. So if you've ever seen Charlton Heston or Prince of Egypt, that's what we're talking about, this story. God leads them through a crazy set of circumstances, through so many providential moments. I mean, things that are just absolutely incredible. He takes them through that whole process. And they get to the edge of the promised land. They get to the edge of everything that God had promised. And he said, listen, this is yours, and you can have this. They get to the edge, and there's a terrible thing that takes place. They send some advanced scouts out. There's some spies, 12 guys out, and they spy the land. They all come back and say, like, this place is unbelievable. This is great. I mean, you got grapes as big as your head. I mean, you just like, this is the best place. Like, this is where we need to be. But here, 10 of them said, here's the problem. The guys in that land that we're going to have to fight, we're going to kick out, they're huge. Like, we're like grasshoppers to them. That's what they said. I mean, they are like big, bad mamma jammas, and we cannot beat them. Like, it's great. It would be awesome, but can't do it. There are two guys that said no. Like, God has gotten us this far. Like, we crossed, like, dry land, Red Sea. You remember that? Like, Egypt. I mean, you remember all the, like, pillar of fire and cloud? I mean, like, food was dropped out of the sky for us. I mean, don't you remember all those things? And these guys are like, this one might be too big. Right? And so God judges them. He says, you can't go into the promised land. In fact, an entire generation is not going to be allowed to go. Only these two guys who were scouts, Joshua and Caleb, are going to be allowed to go. And so for 40 years, the people of God wandered in the desert. They went from this place to that place. God was not going to allow them in the promised land until every one of them had died off, because they didn't have faith in God. They didn't trust God enough. And that's a big deal to God. That's a big deal that we trust him, that he can do anything. Especially when he's proven himself over and over and over and over again. And so finally, all of them, that whole generation, dies off in the wilderness. And so Joshua, one of those spies, becomes the leader of the nation. And now he's responsible for leading the people of God into the promised land, into the thing that God had promised them. But it's going to be a challenge. And one of the greatest challenges they had ahead of them, they got probably about a million, 2 million people somewhere in that neighborhood by this point. That's no small number of people to move. That takes a lot of energy, a lot of effort. Men, women, children, animals, homes, all of that stuff to try to move them into the promised land. And there are people who live there that they've got to evict. And so we've got all these challenges, but God has promised them. In fact, God sends this moment, when what theologians know as Jesus Christ, it's called a Christophany in the Old Testament, where Jesus manifests himself in the Old Testament, and he tells Joshua, be strong and courageous, you don't have to worry, I'll never leave you or forsake you, you're going to be great, I'm going to be with you, I'm going to go ahead of you, everything's going to be fine. So Joshua says, yeah. Well, they got the first challenge. It's not a city. It's not an army. It's a river. It's a river. It's the Jordan River. The Jordan River, it's found in Joshua chapter 3. And so the Jordan River at this time was, you'll find out in a moment, it's harvest time, so it's at flood stage, which means the Jordan River, largest river in all of Israel, goes from north to south, and it's probably at this point, normally it's about 100 feet wide. It's probably a little bit bigger than that because it's at flood stage. Okay. But they've got to get all these people from one side of the river to the next. That's a bit of a challenge, because it's about 10 feet deep. In fact, there are 20, along the Jordan River, there's about 23 different sets of rapids. So it's not just like it's cool, calm water. It's rough stuff. They've got to get people from one side to the other. And so God has this cockamamie idea. He says, listen, Joshua, I want you to take the people of God, I want you to line them up, but I want you to line them up about half a mile behind the priests. And it says this in verse 7. I love what it says. It says of chapter 3 of Joshua. It says, the Lord told Joshua, today I'm going to begin to make you a great leader in the eyes of the Israelites. They will know that I am with you, just as I was with Moses. Give this command to the priests who carry the Ark of the Covenant, which was the presence of God. When you reach the banks of the Jordan River, take a few steps into the river and stop there. So God's instruction is this. This is God's big plan, which sounds crazy, okay? I want you to send the priests into the water and tell them to stop once they get in there. Now, everybody's going to be hanging back on the hill watching this go down. Here's the crazy thing. He takes steps into the water. And all of a sudden, the water, the Bible says upstream, stops flowing. And then here's the crazier thing. And you can read it for yourself this week because we don't have enough time to read it all. But here's the crazier thing. The water stops upstream. So not only is that nuts, like they imagine, they step into water and all of a sudden, whoosh, the water starts just moving. Like, that's pretty incredible. But that could be pretty complicated still. I mean, you got 1 million, 2 million people. I don't know about you, my yard this spring has been like a mud pit. I mean, you walk across it and you've got tracks, right? Imagine 1 million people walking across a wet riverbed. Animals and everything, like, that's not happening. The Bible says not only did they walk across and the waters parted, but they walked across on dry land. Okay, you can say like, well, maybe somebody built a dam up the river, but you can't dry out water or a riverbed that quick. Like, this is unbelievable. Like, this is a huge moment. And see, here's what we got to learn from this before we move on. This is what we got to learn from this. Because we would look at those moments and go, wow, that's incredible. Wow, that's amazing. But this is not the first time they had a water issue, is it? A road obstruction. This is, in fact, many of them had heard these stories from their parents and their grandparents. They had come up on a Red Sea. Big body of water. The Egyptians are running them down. Think like United States military. We are the strongest military in the world. The Egyptians are the strongest military in the world. They have horses. They've got chariots. They got better technology. They got stronger weapons. They got more well-trained soldiers. And they are bearing down on this group of slaves who have like pitchforks. This is going to be a bad situation. They're backed against the wall. And God tells Moses, stretch your rod out over the Red Sea, and the waters are going to part, and he does so. They walk across on dry land. Amazing. And you know what happened? That fueled the faith of God's people. Like, if God can do this, then he's with us. But here, this situation is a little different. This situation, God says, no, you're, Joshua, you're not going to just, like, go part, and it parts. You're going to need to step in the water. See, there are some times when God's going to do have situations in your life where he'll do something and it's going to give you faith. It's going to create faith in your heart. But then there are other times where you have to take the step, and that is what engages the miracle taking place. Where you have to say, okay, I'm going to step into the water. I have no idea how this is going to work out. I have no idea what's going to come next, but I'm going to get into the process. And then God's going to provide along the way. Sometimes God is good, and usually it's at the start of your relationship with Jesus Christ, where God will do things for you, and then you'll be like, oh my goodness, look what God did. But as you grow in your relationship with Jesus Christ, what God is going to ask you to do is, okay, listen, it's not trust if I do it and then you trust. It's trust when you take the steps and then I do it. There's a transition that's taking place in the people of God, where God is asking them to take a step of faith, and then he's going to answer their prayer. And then he's going to provide the miracle. And see, some of you are in the situation where you've been sitting around and sitting back, and you've been going, man, I can't wait for God to move. Whew. Boy, I really wish God would show up. And God's been standing here saying, going, like, step in the water. Like, take the step of faith. Trust me. I've done this and this and this and this and this and this and this. And you can step in the water. You can have faith to do this. But you're going to have to take some risk. You're going to have to step out. Like, I've done those times before in your life where I've like done the big thing, and then you then had the faith to do it. You had the energy to do it. You had the trust to do it. But I'm telling you right now, if you want to do big, big things for God, it requires steps of faith into the river. It requires you to take some risk. It requires you to get uncomfortable. I mean, imagine those priests. They're carrying this box, which is made of like gold. Those aren't light. These dudes are like, they don't have their hands free. Imagine. Okay, Moses, or Josh, you're telling us you want us to walk into the raging flood stage river. And you're just going to hang back? I don't know if I like this plan, Joshua. See, sometimes God's going to say, hey, you need to step out. I believe this. I believe that's where we're at as a church. Where God has done so many things for us in the past. We'll talk about those things in a moment. And it's easy to go, man, whew, look what God has done. Boy, I can't wait for him to do it again. We're just going to sit back and watch. And God is saying, no, you guys have come a little way now. You built up a little relationship with me now. You built up a little trust with me now. Now it's time for you to take some risk. Now it's time for you to take some steps and show that you really do trust me and that you really do believe I'm going to come through every single time. So they step into the water, and it's powerful what takes place. It's powerful what takes place. The water, it recedes back. The Bible says it recedes back all the way to the city of the stream, and there's dry ground. All 1-2 million people get across. All the sheep and all the goats and all the donkeys, all the cows. I mean, everything. Everything is from one side of the river to the other side of the river, and that's an amazing thing. In fact, it's so amazing that Joshua, instructed by the Lord, says, listen, whoa, time out. Time out. We got to stop here. See, it would be easy to go, okay, now that we're across the river, we need to mobilize. This is a staging area for us to go and fight in Jericho. So, awesome God, great work. Now let's get to the real work that you've called us to do. But Joshua is sensitive to the Lord, and he's a great leader. And he realizes, wait. God just did something huge here. And so he calls all the people of God together. In fact, he picks one from each tribe, 12 different tribes, and they build an altar. They take these massive stones, and they put an altar in the middle of the riverbed that is dry. Like literally the place where God did the miracle, and then they did one on the side of the river as well. And they build this altar, and the purpose of this altar is so that generations that would follow would see that pile of rocks. And they would ask, what's that for? What's that for? Listen to it here. Joshua chapter 4 and verse 4. So Joshua called together the 12 men that he had chosen, one from each tribe of Israel. He told them, go into the middle of the Jordan, in the front of the ark of the Lord your God. Each of you must pick up a stone and carry it out over on your shoulder. So this is a big rock, okay? This is not little rock. 12 stones in all, each one for the 12 tribes of Israel. We will use these stones to build a memorial. In the future, your children will ask you, what do these stones mean? Then you can tell them, they remind us that the Jordan River stopped flowing when the Ark of the Lord's Covenant went across. These stones will stand as a memorial among the people of Israel forever. See, there are times in our lives where God has done something so significant and so big that we need to stop. We need to pull back. It would be easy to move on. It would be easy to keep pressing forward. They had a big goal. They need to pound through a bunch of different little cities and a bunch of different little armies and a bunch of little different walls and battlements. But Joshua is so wise and so sensitive to the Lord. He says, listen, time out. We're going to need to remember this. We're going to need to remember this because it's going to get hard in this battle. And it's going to be crazy when we tell the story because what we'll say to them, I mean, think about what this miracle was. It was getting people on, from one side of the river to the other. So literally, it would be like us taking everybody outside and going from one end of the parking lot to the other. That's about how long the journey was. About 100, 150 feet. So like the miracle was, you moved this people from here, like you were here. This is the big miracle. You were here and like, you went over here. Like that's the big miracle. And it's so easy for us to get in those situations where we look back and go, well, that wasn't a big deal. It's so easy for us to go, oh, that's no big deal. And it's easy for us to allow the enemy to speak into our life and have him say, well, that wasn't a big thing. I mean, look, you only went from here to here. What's the big deal? What does that even matter? How did that even make an impact? It's easy for us, for the enemy to speak to our heart and go, well, remember that time you went from here to here? And it was like so small. That was probably just a coincidence, wasn't it? That was probably no big thing. How many of you know some of the biggest miracles in our life are very small? We needed to go from here to here. Well, we need to get from here to here because here to here means that I'm ready to move on from there. And we look at it and go, man, and we tell the story. I've even told stories myself where I said, God did this, and people look at me like a blank stare like, all right? I remember a year and a half ago, we had just launched a nursery and all of our early childhood stuff here at the church, and you know, that was huge for us, getting that all together. And I remember telling somebody, you know, a leader, I can't remember who it was, but I remember telling a leader, hey, I'm so excited this last fall, we launched a nursery. And we launched these different ministries. And he just looked at me like, well, yeah, church has got nurseries. And I'm like, you don't know like what it took to get from this side of the river to that side of the river. You don't know what it took to get me from here to here. Like, that was a miracle. You look at it, and it's small, and I look at it, and it's huge. And we've had so many of those huge moments over the last few years, and even the years that preceded me. Just this week, I was in Minneapolis. I was at this conference that God blessed me with, this great big church that gave me this free conference. I'm just so blessed by them, and it's a phenomenal week, or phenomenal last half of the weekend. So we do this church thing, which every, you know, body does, and we do worship, and then doesn't matter how big, you know, everything is, it still happens. So turn around, you know, greet your neighbor, meet somebody, you know. So I turned around, and I talked to this guy. Turned around, this girl that I knew from college. We like, hey, do we recognize you? Yeah. Oh, okay, that's who this is. So we recognized that we had shared history, and she introduces me to her husband. She says, well, where are you from? I think they're from, like, Minnesota or somewhere in there. And they said, where are you from? I said, well, I'm from Cleveland. Because when you're out and about, that's the easiest thing to say, right? To help people know where you're at. And then he said, well, I grew up in there. I said, oh, then I'm from Aurora. Because, you know, they know the context. And he said, no way. I said, yeah. He said, you know, I got saved in Aurora. I said, really? He said, yeah, there was this, you know where Jaga Lake is? Can I make this stuff up, guys? There's this little church called New Life Assembly. I'm in Minneapolis. Some of you would know him as Rob Purcell. In ministry, doing God's work as a children's pastor. We look at it and go, that's a coincidence, right? Some of the biggest things that will happen in our life are very small. This week I invited you to tell me different stories of how God has impacted you through this church. Got so many different things back, and so many of them were so encouraging. So many encouraging things. I got from Rebecca, which is Chuck and Judy's daughter. They don't go to our church. They're in ministry. They're part of a ministry called Family Life, and they were pastors in Twinsburg. But she sends me this great message. She says, New Life has been such an awesome blessing to my family in so many ways. I've been inviting and bringing kids and friends to the sports camp every single year. Kids can recite all the cheers, proud to wear their t-shirt. My coolest moments was being in my friend's van, non-churchgoers, and hearing all the girls cheer and her kids talk about the camp all year round. Boy, outside looking in, cheers. Big miracle. Life of people who don't know Jesus Christ. For the end, how many times do you know people who've been in relationship to churches, and when they, you say church, immediately, I hate blah, 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 church is blah, 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 blah. And here, through a sports camp, when they hear church, they think, oh man, we got this great church that we send our kids to every summer. Big miracle. Big miracle. I love what Walt shared with me. He had a bypass in 2013, if you remember, if you know him. This is a huge miracle right here. And you're going to think this is so, you might look at this and go, again, man, that's nothing. That's going from one side of the river to the next. But you don't know. Because he wrote this. He said, after my heart bypass in 2013, Linda Kiernan sent me a get well card. This card focused on Isaiah 41:10, which said, fear thou not, for I am with you. Be not dismayed. I am thy God. I will strengthen you, yea. I will help you, yea. I will uphold you with the right hand of my righteousness. He said this. He said, sharing a card and a word of encouragement strengthens the body and cements relationships. Every time I read that verse, I think of Melinda Kiernan. How many of you have ever had a word of encouragement to you at a time when you needed it? And you go, that's no big deal. How many of you have ever said something, you say something nice, and then you find out later that person was totally blown away by what you said to them? Happens to me all the time. Well, I pray a prayer. I pray thousands of prayers with people. They'll say, you don't know what that meant to me. We look at it and go, oh, that's just going from one side of the river to the next. But that right there was their miracle. That's what they needed to get to where they needed to be. Yes, it was maybe a short journey, but it was an important journey. It was a significant journey. I think it was Cheryl. Cheryl's a single mom. She said this. She said, I grew up going to Catholic school and going to church every Sunday. It felt like a chore to my 11-year-old self. She's got a son in our children's ministry. She says, I love the fact that John is so impatient to learn more about God. I love the fact that he's, I love how she wrote, is so impatient to learn more about God. Next, the doors open, she says, and we are greeted with a smile and genuine and firm handshake and a welcome. I always feel like I'm being centered when I'm here. Think of so many stories. Got this wonderful, I'll tell you, I got this wonderful letter from Barb Phillips. I can't share it all. I wish I could, maybe sometime I will. She shares the journey that she's been on with, as you many of you know, her husband passed in the fall. And John was just a dear, everybody who has been a part of this church for a long time knows just how much we miss him and loved him, and just the joy that he brought to our lives. Me, as he was on our board, as on our leadership team. And she shares this wonderful truth as the church began to wrap around her and love her and just do simple things. It created an environment for all of her kids to come back to the Lord. Big miracles. Big miracles. And see, this is why we remember. This is why we build up the rocks in our lives. Because there's going to come a time in the future, as a church, as individuals, it's going to get tough. I promise. It's one of the things I can promise. Jesus is one of the greatest promises of Jesus. In this world, you will have what? Tribulation, trouble. It's a promise. And in those times, when you're wondering how it's going to happen, and you're wondering if it can, you can make it, and if you're wondering if this faith step is worth it, or you can even take that step, God's going to do this. He's going to miss it. Remember that time? Remember that time? And it was, for you, it's just getting from one side of the river to the next, but Remember how I? Remember what I did? If you've been at New Life for any length of time, you know the stories of just even the past 5 years that I've been a pastor here. So the stories that I've been sharing with you, there's stories that go way beyond that. But the stories that I've been sharing with you, you know, been in the journey with you on, the times when we were going, hey, how are we going to put a roof on a building? Remember that journey? We all go, how are we going to, that's way too much money for our church. Way too, and we started a journey, we built a church in Cuba, following the faith step of our God, saying, if you'll build a church there, I'll take care of your roof here. And as we get to that point, we get roofers on the roof, and they say, you need to call your insurance company. And not only is this roof paid for, but the roof over my house was paid for as well. It's our pile of rocks. It's our pile of rocks where we look back at the moments. We look back at the moments, and we say, look what the Lord has done. In that same campaign, we took the money that we raised, and we said, you know, we have this stuff we'd like to do. We gave it away. And one of those things was chairs, if you remember. Chairs in the facility. When you know it, church in Delaware says, hey, we got chairs. Here are $7,000 worth of chairs, almost the same amount as what we needed, or as what we had given away. Can't make this stuff up. You can't make this stuff up. And the truth is that we have to remember what God has done. Now, here's the challenge. Here's the challenge, is our past should remind us, but it should not define us. Our past should remind us, but it should not define us, good, bad, or otherwise. See, how easy would it have been? Boy, God got us across the river. Well, we could just hang out right here. Like, this is pretty good. We can hang out right here. They could have built camp. They could build homes. They could build everything. We got a water source. We got, you know, we could do this. I mean, we wouldn't have to fight any battles. We wouldn't have to take any cities. We could just hang out right here. But that's not what God had for them, was it? God had something for them that was much greater, but it could have been easy to hang by the river. And how foolish would it have been for them to experience this incredible miracle to get them closer to the promised land, for them to hang out in the past of what God had done. See, God gives us these things to propel us forward, not to keep us going nowhere. Not to hold us where we're standing still. That miracle was a staging miracle so that they could go fight in Jericho and bring the walls down. That's what that miracle is for. But how many times have you and I done this in our lives where God does something great, and then the next day or the next week or the next month or the next year, when God's asking us to do it yet again, we sit back and go, boy, but God, remember you did this? That was good. And God's saying, well, I want to do that. No, God, I know you, but listen, this was awesome. I'm good here. And God's saying, no, that's not what that was for. That miracle was so that you could get somewhere else. We don't live in yesterday's story. We don't live in yesterday's pathway. God's plan for them was that they would inherit the land. God's plan for them was to go into the promised land where they wouldn't have to plow their own fields and they wouldn't have to build their own homes. It was always going to be provided for them. It was a land flowing with milk and honey, which for us in the 21st century doesn't mean a whole lot, but for them, that was the jam. Like, that was the best. That was where it's at. It's really easy to get comfortable. But there are more victories to be won. There are more miracles to experience. There's a promised land to inherit. You know, we can never have too many miracle moments. We can never have too many stories of life change. There cannot ever be too many stories of Rob Purcell. There can't ever be too many stories of Rod Buescher. I don't know how many of you know his story, and I'm just pulling this one out of the air, and he shared it publicly, so I don't really care anyway. So, who is, what, 17? How old were you? 19 years old, unchurched family, walked through the doors of this church and got saved in this church. has found his way back to this church. There cannot be too many of those stories of life transformation in our church. There cannot be too many of those, but there can be too few. I'm going to say that again. There cannot be too many stories of life transformation through our church, but there can be too few. There are plenty of churches out there that exist for themselves. They got their own little stuff and their own little plans, and they're not making any impact in the world. And Jesus looks on that with disgust. Because Jesus says to his disciples, go into all the world and make disciples of all nations. Like, go out there and make this thing happen. I came to transform people's lives. So if you're not a part of transformation, you are walking against what God has planned for you. Whew, preaching now, huh? God has got a plan for your life. He wants transformation in you. We say it all the time. Transformation in you and transformation through you. Transformation in you and transformation through you. And the truth is, like, God has brought us so far, right? We've just told so many stories of how God has brought us so far. And I am so excited by that. There are so many more stories in this, right? People come out to me all morning going, oh man, I forgot to email you, or I forgot to send you, or I forgot. And listen, so many stories of how God has done so many things, but I never want the stories of yesterday to stall me in the stories of the future. I never want yesterday's blessing. That's good. I'm glad. We celebrate it. We stand and shout. We cry. We jump up and down, but we never want to live there. Past can remind us, but my goodness, let it not define us. Let it not define us. See, we've got some battles ahead of us. We got some victories to be won. How many of you know, like, we like the victory, right? Amen? Right? You can't have victory without a battle. Oh, man. That's not as encouraging, is it? You can't have victory without a battle. I got some military guys in this room that know this very well. Like, you won some battles, but you know that the victory came at a cost. Like, you know that. And see, I believe we've got some victories ahead of us, some big ones. And at the beginning of this year, we talked about how this vision for transformation, you're not going to stop hearing me talk about this vision for transformation, transforming our city through family, which we have been wildly invested in this year. So exciting. Transform our city through family. We saw 26 people at a parenting seminar a couple weeks ago. We send out emails every single week to parents. We get stuff, feedback all the time from parents. Not only that, it's been crazy how God has used this as a platform for church. Literally, churches across the country are latching onto this thing that we just, like, thought might be a great idea the Lord's leading us into. So not only our church, like churches all over. Transform our city through family. Transforming a region through planting. We're going to be doing some of this stuff. We got some church planters we're going to talk about in the next couple of coming weeks that we're going to be partnering with here in our area that are going to, they're just rocking the world, the universe. Transforming the subculture, the university campus at Kent State. Transforming the world through that sacrifice. And it comes. A transformation in us, where God does a work in us, and then God transforms through us. God transforms through us. Because I'm going to be honest with you. If we don't see life transformation in our church, I just can't make it. I hope you understand what I'm saying there. Like, if we don't see lives changed by the power of Jesus Christ, I just need to hang it up, because I can do a lot of things that are a lot less stressful. But I believe that Jesus wants to use this church to make a difference in our world. I believe that. I believe that God wants to do something powerful in us, but not just in us, because that's selfish if it's just in us. But God wants to do something through us, and there's going to be some victories ahead of us. But let me tell you, to get to the victory, there are going to be battles. There are going to be hard times. There are going to be sacrifices. There's going to be difficulties. We've got some work to do. We all, many of you signed commitment forms this beginning of this year saying, I want to reach one person to reach 1% of our community, where we would, over the next 3 to 5 years, add 1% of our community to our church. And we were excited in January, right? It's May. How you doing? We're excited. Today, before we close, I want to highlight two, because I want to be specific with you. If you're a guest here today, like this is, some of this is family talk, so I get it, and you can like check out and think about your calendar and all that kind of stuff. But for the family that's here today, I want to share two battles that are ahead of us. Two things that I think we've got to pray about and consider giving toward and sacrificing toward, because this is huge. As we talk about reaching 1% of our communities, we talk about transformation, life transformation, two things. There's stuff that you already know, okay? So this is not new to you. One is our vision for transformation, like the facility adjustments we're making. So as you've seen in our fellowship hall, in our common area, their multi-purpose room there on through that wall, we've done a lot in there. We were able to complete that project like $1,500 under budget. The glory of Jesus Christ. And we did a little, trust me, I do a little dance when that happens. It gets Pentecostal real quick. But $3,500, what that was supposed to cost, $5,000, it was much cheaper. We're just so thankful to the Lord for that. We were able to get one of our other projects done, which is get the outdoor sign completed, and so thankful to the Lord for that. Our next project is to open up our lobby to make it more us more able to receive as many people as we can and open this up wildly. That's going to take $5,000. We're about halfway there. We're about halfway there. Those are battles that we need to win. And there are weeks, I'm going to be leveled with you here, pastor of faith and power here. There are weeks that I look at that fund and I go, whew, at this rate, we'll be completing the vision for transformation in about 15 years. We need your help. And it's not about like who can give the most and what. It's about you saying, Lord, what do you want to give? What do you want me to do? Which is it's a really dangerous sentence to say to the Lord, and a question to ask. Like, what do you want me to do? Well, God probably is going to scare your pants off, okay, just so you know. But it's asking, what do you want me to do? Because it's not about brick and mortar. It's not about change of facility. It's about making this place more receptive to people so that they can come to know Jesus Christ. It's never about brick and mortar. Who cares about this building? Who cares? This is a tool that we use for God's kingdom and for God's glory. I love it. I'm thankful for it. I'm thankful. Trust me. I'm thankful. But this is a tool that we use for God's kingdom and for God's glory to reach people. That's it. This building will be left behind in the rapture. I hate to tell you, it's not going to make it to heaven. That's one of the battles we got to fight, one of the victories we've got to have. We want just so you know in my heart, and I'm not saying this is put pressure on you, I want you to know what I would love to see. I would love that our vision for transformation project in its entirety, all of it, could be done no later than halfway through next year. No later. I would really love to see it done by the end of the year. I've got that much crazy faith in my heart. But it takes everybody saying, yeah, we're going to fight this battle. We're going to fight this battle. The other battle that we've got to fight, the victories that we have to win, as we talk about reaching our community, is this summer. How many of you know Northeast Ohio has some unique weather all the way from September to apparently about 2 weeks ago? You know, I talked to a lot of friends who are pastors, and they do all these different things that are outreaches, and they're all that's outdoor stuff, and I'm like, oh, I would love to do that, except that it's like winter, like all year long, except for June, July, and August. Which means that we have a responsibility to steward that time really well. Because as we get out of our building and get out and do stuff in the community, we've got to steward that time really well. So I'm going to let you know, we're going to work hard this summer as a church. We're going to work really hard. And I'm going to say something that some of you might be offended by. So this is just one of those sermons. So just hang in there. I will never be ashamed of asking you for your time and money, because when you get to heaven, you'll be thankful for it. You'll thank me. Because we waste our time and our money on all kinds of stuff that's not kingdom related, but boy, we can put our time, energy, and money into stuff that's going to expand the kingdom both here and around the world. One of those things is to participate in our 4th of July parade. We've got some crazy ideas about how to build fun relationships with our community. We're starting to become known in our community, and that's so great. So one of the things we need your help with is that day. Coming up on July the 4th, take we'll go in the parade, and we're going to have a very cool booth that it's going to be so fun, and it's going to make a positive impact in our community. The second thing, which many of you know about, is our sports camp. I love sports camp. How many of you have participated in Mega Sports Camp? Come on now, raise them loud and proud. There you go. So sports camp is absolutely one of the most fun things we do all year, one of the most impactful things we do all year. In fact, I look at a family that's here today, and the reason they're here today was because of sports camp last year, and they're nodding their head at me. The reason they're here today, they're plugged into this church, into this family, is because of sports camp. And I love our Mega Sports Camp. Now, here's the crazy thing that happened last year. I want to share some testimonies. We had 80 kids last year. 80 kids. Now, 80 kids have got a lot of parents, right? Sports camp was packed. I mean, if you were there at the parent night, like there were like 250, 300 people here. And half our parking lot was basketball courts. So it got crazy here. So what we realized was we've got a great problem we've got to solve. And so this year at sports camp, we are going to be doing a little thing that's unique. And again, it's going to take some steps of faith. It's going to take some involvement. Is we did a pre-K version last year, pre-K and kindergarten, and we did our elementary version all the same week. And that was great. But what we didn't anticipate was that our early childhood, our pre-K and kindergarten, would like be full first year, 40 kids. We can't do any more than 80 kids, really. We can't. And so we had a lot of discussions around boardroom and a lot of discussions with our ministry team leaders and said, what are we going to do? How are we going to solve this problem? We either say no to kids, which I'm going to tell you I'm not ready to do. I'm just never going to do that, okay? I'm not going to say no to kids and families. We could relocate to a different location. So we could do it at the high school, whatever. Now, here's the problem with that. We did a study last year, and like 70% of Aurora has no idea that we're here. Couldn't find our church if they wanted to. So it's really important that we locate it at our facility, okay, just strategically. We want them to come to our building so they know where we're at. So that means we have to split the camp, okay? We have to do two camps, and that's what we're going to do this year. It's going to be all in one week. So Sunday to Tuesday, we're doing little kids. It's just going to be great. If you've ever seen little kids play soccer, there is nothing better than watching little kids play soccer. If you're having a bad day, T-ball is on Saturday morning, so is soccer here in Aurora. Just go watch it. You'll have a better day. Promise. You'll just have a better day. Like, there's nothing better. Okay? So Sunday to Tuesday, you little kids. Wednesday to Saturday morning, we are going to be doing our elementary, and then that Sunday is going to be a huge day. Our family day is going to be on Sunday. Well, we're going to have Sunday morning service, and I'm so excited about this. Sunday morning service, and then we're going to have just cookout and thinking about inflatable games and all kinds of fun stuff right after church. So it's going to be like you get to come to church in shorts. I know many of you do. I'm going to come to church in shorts, so be ready for that. But it's going to be incredible. And some of you are like, what? I don't know if I even love Jesus. But so it's going to be crazy on this day. In fact, be in prayer about this. I hesitate even sharing this because it's so big and so huge. But be in prayer about this. We have a relational connection with a guy by the name of Kurt Warner, if you know who that is. There's a possibility he'll be our guest speaker on that day, which would be pretty significant. So be in prayer about that. We're trying to work out all this stuff, and it may not work out, but we've also got another professional football player that we're friends with that will back us up on that. So anyhow, we're going for broke on this deal. And we might be broke after it's all done. I don't know. But we're doing it, not because we just want to throw big events. It's a victory we need to win because someone out there is losing the battle. There's some family that needs to find the love and acceptance that's found here through Jesus Christ. So we go for broke because we know that Jesus is on the other side of that. We take the steps of faith. We step into the water because we know Jesus every time.